So you will have the control too.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. So let me
get started. I'll get
started. Okay. So is it possible we can connect this here? I request all participants to put their mic on the mute. Maybe folks over here needs to do that too. I don't know whether the echo will come or not. Shankar.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not even joined on.
Oh, you have not joined? Okay. Sounds good. Okay, so let me get that started. So my name is Paresh. We are going to have the session on RabbitMQ today. Many of you might be aware of or might have worked on messaging systems. So this is one of the messaging systems, which is also many times it is called as MOM, which is called as a message oriented middleware or the messaging infrastructures. There are many other players in the market. We'll be covering up the introductions with few of them, but we'll be doing up a more deep dive into RabbitMQ, and we are going to have complete hands-on to understand what are the capabilities which are available from RabbitMQ as being a broker, and what all we can do as a part of RabbitMQ in our systems. So what are we going to cover today? We are going to understand, first of all, what messaging systems is, what are the benefits of using a messaging systems, what are the benefits of using the MOM-based architectures. We'll do some sort of vis-a-vis comparisons of messaging systems with the other architectures that we already know or that we are implementing. We'll understand the AMQP model. AMQP is the protocol specifications, messaging protocol specifications. So we'll try to understand what that model covers, what are the different terminologies that AMQP supports. We'll also understand the RabbitMQ as a part of the introductions, that what are the RabbitMQ capabilities and what features are available as a part of RabbitMQ. We'll do the hands-on in terms of installing the RabbitMQ on our machines and then starting up the broker, connecting with the RabbitMQ, and we'll do the basic publishing and subscribing of the messages onto the broker side. We'll understand the messaging patterns, which is more deep dive into understanding what are the exchanges, what are the routing, what are the binding types, what are the failover mechanisms, and we'll also try to understand how do we associate virtual host, or how do we associate the dead letter queues, dead letter exchanges, how we can configure dead letter exchanges and the other queue attributes with the infrastructure. We'll do some hands-on onto that in terms of we'll be trying to create some of the exchanges. We'll be trying to associate our queues with the exchanges. We'll try to play around with publishing the messages onto the different exchanges based on the routing patterns, and we'll look into that. How does it behave? So let's try to first of all understand what is a messaging systems. In a very nutshell, the messaging system is something which allows overall architecture to be loosely coupled. Most of the time, whenever we design the enterprise systems, whereby the enterprise which is having many systems or many components which want to talk to each other, there are two major patterns which comes in. One of the major patterns that comes in is the synchronous pattern, whereby everyone talks to another systems, keeping in mind that I want the response back itself immediately. But it is not advisable, or in some of the situations you don't want to do that. Some of the situations you want to do that, like fire and forget, that I am sending you something, I don't care when that message is would be processed, when it is going to be processed, and then how it is going to be taken care of. So that is more a scenario called as a non-blocking. So in a situation something like this, say for instance, we have the enterprise which is having the 50 odd applications, and then all of these applications are having the exceptions. We want to centralize the exceptions into some central place. All the applications would be, the error notifications would be sent to some of the messaging systems that these are the errors which has been occurred. And the application does not care when those error messages are getting processed or when they are getting processed. One of the use case of having a non-blocking systems is like, say for the instance, in a retail company, we have these separate promotions. We want to send that promotions to all physical retail stores, so which is spread across the country level. These all promotions needs to be sent to the country level from some centralized ERP systems or some sort of centralized SAP systems. At that time also, we'll be using of the non-blocking or the async. So the major benefit of having a non-blocking is that the system scales. Second thing is the applications are loosely coupled. They are horizontally scalable architectures, and then you can even process something like, let's say, 10,000 or 50,000 messages in a second, kind of. Guaranteed delivery. This is an important phenomenon which states that once a message is actually being published by the publisher, these infrastructures should support that the message has to be processed in any condition. Say for instance, we are having an order processor systems. Now, irrespective of what, whether it is a network failure or whether it is infrastructure issues or whether it is a application issues, once the order is created, we want to make sure that the order is processed. And that's what something which we mean by the guaranteed delivery. And we look into the rabbiting examples that how can we achieve guaranteed delivery. The publishers and the subscriber needs to ensure that the messages are published successfully and the messages are consumed successfully. So whether it is an exception at the consumption side or whether it is infrastructure issues, that needs to be addressed by the messaging systems. As I said earlier, it needs to be scalable. When we are designing these systems, the systems might start with, let's say, 100 messages per second, but these messaging systems need to ensure that it can scale up to 10,000 messages per second or maybe 100,000 messages per second. The messaging systems need to be clustered and be highly available. So it should not happen that if we are having a messaging systems which is being created with one node, so if the node goes down, then everything is down. Publishers will not be able to publish the messages. Subscriber will not be able to consume the messages. At the same time, it needs to be highly available in the sense that once you do it clustered, you want to also ensure that the systems are highly available in the sense that the queue which resides on a node, if the node goes down, still your messages should not be removed. Whenever the node comes up, or even if the node does not come up, the other nodes which are available as a part of the cluster, they should be able to allow the subscriber to consume the message. This is something which is multi-tenancy support. So many times we want to have the multi-tenant systems to be created. And those are the situations where the RabbitMQ has got the virtual host capabilities. Virtual host is more like logical grouping of the systems into which the queues, exchanges, bindings, routings, everything would get grouped together. And this can be, so you can create multiple logical groups, and each of the logical group can be associated with one tenant. So let us understand some of the players which are available as a part of the messaging systems, which provides of the messaging capabilities. One of the very well-known name is ActiveMQ. ActiveMQ is something which is one of the largest player in the market. Whenever it comes to GMS-based messaging infrastructures, the default name is ActiveMQ. This is Apache-based one. There is one more player which we are going to do today is RabbitMQ. This is being managed by the Pivotal. Pivotal is what the Spring company, which is managing of the Spring. And RabbitMQ is based on the MQP specifications. We look into what MQP specification is. There are other players. One is a HornetQ. Hornet Q is a JBoss, JBoss-based messaging infrastructure. So that is being managed by, so as a part of the JBoss application servers, Hornet Q is a default messaging implementations, which is available. This Hornet Q is claimed to be the highest, it processes more number of messages compared to the RabbitMQ or the ActiveMQ. That's what they are claiming. SQS is an AWS infrastructure, so which provides the messaging capabilities available as a service onto the AWS infrastructure. Kafka is also becoming very famous. This is something which has started gaining more attention compared to the other infrastructures, but it is not completely full blown messaging broker, but it does a lot in terms of throughput and the scalability part compared to the other messaging systems. IBM WebSphere MQ is one of the old like TIBCO which provided the MQ capabilities since long, and it is one of the well known, and there are many implementations which is based on the WebSphere MQ. So let us understand first of all AMQP. AMQP is Advanced Messaging Queuing Protocol. So this is a protocol specification, and this is an open standard. So basically, JP Morgan Chase they started having the messaging based infrastructures, which was only for their organizations, and some point of time they realized that they wanted to have this to be turned out into an specifications, and then that's how the AMQP specifications derived. One of the primary objective of AMQP specification is it should allow intercommunications between the brokers. When I say brokers, which means that different vendor systems should be able to communicate with each other as a part of messaging infrastructure. So AMQP or any other messaging systems, which one of the major capabilities are publishers, consumers, and the messaging systems, they all can reside on in a distributed infrastructures kind of. They do not need to be onto the same infrastructures, and that's how it scales, and that's how it provides the capabilities of intercommunications into a loosely coupled manner. So if you compare with the JMS, so JMS is known to the many of the people, but JMS is more of an Java API from the programming perspective. So say for the instance, if you're using ActiveMQ and if you want to switch over to the another broker, you don't want to do any programmatic programming side change. So it is more of an API based whereby the Java API specification, JMS is Java API specifications, whereas AMQP is a more of a protocol specification. So we should not get confused end of the day that JMS versus AMQP. As far as ActiveMQ is concerned, as I said earlier, it is one of the default broker as far as JMS is concerned. RabbitMQ is default as far as AMQP is concerned. But ActiveMQ has announced that it will be supporting of the AMQP 1.0 specification. And so that's something which is going to be providing up the interoperability, though RabbitMQ has not is not supporting 1.0 specification at this moment. If we'll compare up the AMQP versus HTTP, HTTP and AMQP both are application layer protocols, but they serve the different purpose altogether. So HTTP in most of the scenarios, whenever we use, which is more for the REST endpoints or more for the web perspective. So whereby those are more of a synchronous operations in nature. Whenever we say, when we talk about AMQP messaging protocol, we are talking about the asynchronous operations in nature. Asynchronous in manner that publishers publishes the messages and then it just gets disconnected so that it can resume the remaining operations. So if you'll understand of the AMQP overview, there are three major things which is available. One is publisher on the left hand side, which is responsible for pushing in the messages to the broker systems. And on the right hand side, we have consumers, which is responsible for consuming the messages from the broker systems. In the broker system, which is also called as a messaging system, there are two major entities. One is the exchanges, and second is a queue. Exchanges are something which is responsible to accept the message from the publisher. Exchanges are also responsible to route the message to the specific queue based on the routing mechanisms. We'll look into some of the examples that whenever the publisher publishes the messages to the broker, it specifies two major things. One is to what exchange name the message are getting published, and second is with what routing key the messages are getting published. The queues are more of a nature like buffers. Buffers where the messages resides. Once a message is actually getting published to the queue is basically either durable or the persistence. We look into the more details, but the queue ensures that the messages are actually getting consumed by the consumer. So the consumer connects to the queue and then it picks up the messages. Consumer does not need to know what exchange to which this queue belongs to. Publishers does not care to what queue it is publishing a message. This is very important to understand, because publishers publishes the message to the exchange based on a routing key. The messages are being published to the queue, while the consumer says that any message is getting published to the queue, I want to consume it. Once the message comes to the queue, it is up to the consumers at what time, at what frequency the message needs to be consumed. And there are pull and the push mechanisms available whereby the consumers keeps on pulling the queue that I want to have the messages to look for, whether the messages are available or not. And second is the callback kind of mechanisms, which talks about as soon as the message is available into the queue, the consumer will be notified. So if we'll understand of the AMQP model into the more detail now, if you look at over here, we have the queues which is residing, which is being shown as a green box over there. So there are multiple queues. And if you look at the exchanges, there are different kind of exchanges which is being supported as a part of the AMQP specifications and the RabbitMQ supports that. We'll look into all the details. So three major exchanges which is being noted down over here, which is a topic exchange, fanout exchange, and the direct exchange. So these exchanges have their own mechanisms, way to push in the message to the separate queue. So we will look into the details. So the difference is a direct exchange are more like point-to-point exchange. So whenever the message is being published to the direct exchange with a specific routing key, it is being published to only one queue. Right, fan-out exchange are more like a broadcast mechanisms whereby the message which is published to the fan-out queue will get replicated to all the queues which is connected to the fan-out exchange.
All or
just some? No, whenever you want to do publishing to only some specific queues, that is more, that does not call as a broadcast, but that call as a multicast. So say for instance, I'm interested in understanding of the messages which is buy one get one promotion, say for this. So any promotions which has got a buy one get one, I'm interested in. In that case, that is more of like, if you look at the Q1, that has got some kind of star which is being defined. So if you have the buy one get one dot west or buy one get one dot east, messages would be published to that queue. But if the promotion is not buy one get one, or if it's a promotion is more of a percentage oriented, then those messages will not be published. So in a nutshell, topic is more of a multicasting nature. When we look into the examples, we'll understand in more detail. While fanout is more like a broadcast. It just copies the messages to all queues to which the fanout is being bound to. The queues, as we understand, it's more like a buffer where the messages resides. Bindings. Bindings are something based on which the exchanges connect to the queues, right? So bindings are basically nothing but the routing name. Say for instance, you have a queue name, but the binding name is Q1, which means that any message which comes to the exchange, it will look into the binding, and based on the binding, it will put the respective message to the queue. as I said, bindings from the topic would be more like the expression, but binding from the direct exchange is more like the specific string match sort of comparison. Publishers are the client APIs or the client components, which is responsible for pushing in the message. Consumers are again the clients, which can consume the messages. RabbitMQ and the other messaging infrastructures does support the scalability in terms of if you have, say for the instance, 10,000 messages at this per second getting published, one consumer is not capable enough to process all the messages. So it is possible that you can register multiple consumers to the queue, which provides these capabilities. So say for the instance, if you have 10 consumers registered with the queue, and if the 10 messages are getting published to the queue, each consumer will pick up one message at a time to process it. So that if you know that the message rates are going to be higher, you can register more consumers, and the messaging infrastructures will ensure that the messages are being delivered to the consumers in a round-robin fashion. Acknowledgements. This is more like a transactional capabilities available into the messaging infrastructures, which talks about not only guaranteed delivery, but it talks about at least once kind of message to be processed. Typical example is like when a producer is processing the messages and something goes wrong with the producer, that message needs to be processed again, right? Which means that it is the responsibility of the consumer to send the acknowledgement to the messaging systems that we want my message is actually being processed successfully and it should be deleted from the queue, which also ensures that unless the acknowledgement is not being sent, that message is not being removed from the queue. So say for the instance, when you're using the JDBC, once the transactions gets committed, you ensure that you are 100% sure that your data has been persisted to the database systems, RDBMS systems. Same thing stands over here. Once a consumer sends an acknowledgement that the message is successfully being consumed, the queue, which is the broker, basically deletes the message from the queue, which also ensures that the processing of the message has been successfully completed. It is possible that the consumer can send a negative acknowledgement, or the consumers sends the broker infrastructures that something went wrong while processing the message. I want this message to be reprocessed, or I want to publish this message to the dead letter queue. Connections and channels. This is interesting, and this is where AMQP differs compared to the other messaging systems. Each connection from the AMQP perspective represent a TCP connection. Right, and inside the TCP connections, you can create as many virtual channels, which is called as the as many virtual connections as possible. So, from the typical application perspective, one TCP connections is capable enough to push in messages or to consume the messages in the infrastructure itself. So, you do not need to have, say, for the instance, if you have the multi-threaded systems whereby you want to send 100 messages. You don't need to have the connection pool, or you don't need to have the 100 connections to be created onto the broker side. Only one connections, and every connection can give you a channel. And the channel is something by which you can either publish the message or you can consume the messages. So channels are more of a nature of the virtual connections which lies within the TCP IP. Virtual host, as we said, if you look at into the diagram, all of these exchanges, bindings, and the queues, they are getting grouped together and they are being given a name as a virtual host over here. DLX are more of a dead letter exchanges. And that's where if something goes wrong with the consumer side, the messages needs to be sent to the dead letter queue. So let's quickly understand RabbitMQ. RabbitMQ is one of the open source messaging broker, which supports or implements the AMQP specifications. It is written into an Erlang programming language. It provides client libraries in the different programming languages, Java, C Sharp, Python, Ruby. Almost every language's client libraries are available, which allows the messages to be published to the broker. So it is possible that your publisher is written in a Java language while your consumers are in the C Sharp. So it provides complete programming interoperability. It is one thing to understand over here is that even though the RabbitMQ as a broker is being written into the Erlang programming language, you don't need to know the Erlang at all. It is just that it is an Erlang which is a prerequisite for everyone to run a broker available onto the machine. So if you want to run the RabbitMQ on your machine, you need to make sure like Erlang is installed on your machine. Like if you have a normal Java application, it requires a JDK kit. Same way it needs to have the Erlang to be installed on your machine. It runs on the major operating systems.
No.
That's one of the reasons why the entire architecture is called as a loosely coupled architecture. Irrespective of what your consumers is publishing a message from which language, the broker does not care because the APIs can be a Java based or a C Sharp based, while the consumers can be of any of the language based. Okay.
Harish, sorry to interrupt, but whenever you guys want to take a break, some bagels.
Sure.
Okay.
Thank you. It provides rich features, direct dead letter exchanges, virtual host. We'll look into these all details when I'll give you the demo for the clusters and the high available queues or the mirror queues. We'll look into the details. So right on to the installation side, I'll just show how the RabbitMQ can be installed onto my machine. I hope everyone can look into my screen. So RabbitMQ should be so on the RabbitMQ side, we have the installation which allows the RabbitMQ to be downloaded. As far as the Mac machines are concerned, you can just click on this tar.gz file, which is a tarball. You can untar that using a tar.xvf command. So you can use tar.xvf and then RabbitMQ over here, tar.gz. So once you'll give this will create a RabbitMQ directory onto your current directory structure. You can just go to RabbitMQ server and spin. The only thing which needs to be known before you guys install, I'll give you the time to install, that the Erlang needs to be installed. So, and for that reason, I have given the Erlang installation onto this. So I can just copy this couple of links to the chat, or you guys can just Google it and then set it up. But in the nutshell, whenever you go to the SPIN, which is basically the directory where RabbitMQ is installed, and the SPIN directory, we can just go to RabbitMQ server, and this will start the broker. As soon as the broker is started, the broker, as I said earlier, broker is something in which you have the exchanges, in which you have the queues also. So once the broker is actually being started on your machine, you need to install the plugin. But just from the demo perspective, I'll just quickly show what is a wave of the broker looks like. So if you look at onto my screen here, this is the web UI by which you can administer or manage the broker. So the first thing that you can do is, if you look at the queue side, it will list down all the different queues which is being listed. So quickly, what I'll do is I'll just create a queue. Say for the instance, I'm creating a queue which is named as a clairvoyant queue. So there are two kind of queues available. One is a durable queue and one is a transient queue. Durable queues are those queues once a node gets down or once the node gets restarted, the durable queues comes up automatically. If you are creating a non-durable queue, and the, if the node goes down, when the node comes up, the queue will not be available over there. So let me create up the two queues over here. One is a durable queue, which I named as a Clairvoyant Queue Durable. So if you look at right now, Clairvoyant Queue Durable, and that is being denoted as a D, which means that it's a durable queue. And I'm creating up the another queue, which is Clairvoyant Queue Transient. And I'm creating a transient queue. I'm adding a queue over here. Right. I'm giving this demo from the web perspective. Same thing you can do using a Java APIs or any other programming language APIs, which allows the queues to be created using the APIs. So programmatically, you can create the queue itself. I'll show some of the sample programs. But if you look at the difference over here, the transient queue is not being shown as a D part over here. The difference lies is, if I'll stop the broker over here, which is more like a control C, either you can use a control C, which means that the broker is being stopped, or you can use RabbitMQ, or you can use RabbitMQ CTL and stop. This command will also stop the broker. So on, as far as your private environment is concerned, you can just stop the broker, but just by pressing the control C, or you can open up the another terminal window and close that. So as soon as you'll do that, if you'll see over here onto the web UI, it says that the broker is down. It is not able to get connected. You can go back and try to start the broker again. If you'll do a refresh, if you look at the transient queue is gone, which means that the queue which is transient does not survive on the node restart. So most of the time, you may or may not require the durable queue in nature, because as far as the API is concerned, when you are publishing a message to the queue, the API gives you the capabilities. If the queue is not existing, it will create the queue for you. So you don't need to create the durable queue. The benefit of having a durable queue is persistent messages. So say for the instance, in the queue, I'll go inside the queue and I'll publish a message over here. So in the web UI, it allows you to publish the message. So let's say I'm publishing the message, which is named as a test message over here. I'll look into the details of these headers and everything in the later, but the message is being published successfully. So we publish the message into the queue. If you look at over here in the queued message, it just shows that there is one message which is residing into the queue. It also shows you the rate at which the number of messages are getting published. And it is possible to view the message into the queue, which is more like, I just want to view the message. So if you look at the get message, it shows you the payload, which is the test message. So what is a message? So message basically comprises of the two major things. One is what message payload, what actually message payload that we are publishing. Also, it includes the information about to what exchange the message is getting published with what routing key, right? The question is, we have not provided any routing key or any bindings, any informations while publishing the message. It is because whenever you create any queue in the broker, it is bound to the default exchange. This default exchange, if you look at the exchanges, over here, if you look at the AMQP default, that's a default exchange. So any queue that we create, that will be bound to a default exchange. And that's the reasons why it does not show that. So let's now consume the message. So to consume the message, if you look at when you're consuming the message, it gives the capability of requeuing or not. Requeuing in the sense that when you say no, which means it will fetch the message from the queue, but it will delete the message from the queue also, which is more like sending an acknowledgement to the queue that message is successfully consumed over there. So when you say a message is being the same test message, but if you look at over here, the message is being deleted from the queue because you said requeue, which is equal to no.
So is this option available for publishers, or is it fine to publish?
That's a good question. So as far as publisher is concerned, publisher is interested into ensuring that my message is successfully published to the queue. Let's say you are publishing a message to a wrong exchange, or you are publishing a message with a wrong routing key so that the exchange is not capable to push it to the right queue. Then you can publish the message in such a manner that if I'm at all publishing a message with a wrong routing key, or if the exchange is down or something is going wrong, then I want to get a notification. And that's possible onto the Java side. I'll show you the demo, whereby if I publish the message with the wrong routing key, it will send an exception back to the publisher that the message is not successfully being published. Right? But from the consuming side is more like an acknowledgement, which is something by which I want to delete the message onto the from the queue.
In this scenario, we are publishing a message and consuming it. So how is it different for durable versus transient?
Sure. So let me do this thing. So right now, as far as this queue is concerned, there are no messages, right? Now I'm publishing two messages over here. One is I'm publishing a persistent message over here. What does the persistent means? Persistent means that if a node restarts, my message should come back to the queue, right?
Because it's not delivered
yet. No, it is delivered. So say for instance, I'm publishing a persistent message over here. Now this message was being sent with a delivery mode type persistent, which means that the message will be returned to the hard disk, which is basically a file systems, which is basically a persistent store. So as a message is being sent to the durable queue as being a persistent message, the message, when the confirmation comes back that the message is being sent to the queue, which means that the message is not in RAM, but message is actually committed to the persistent systems.
What if you are sending a
persistent now message? If you are sending up the non-persistent message over here, right? So let's say this is not to be persisted. So over here, if you look at right now, there are two messages which are residing into the queue. One is a persistent message and one is a non-persistent message. So if you look at right now, the queue has got two messages. We have not consumed these messages. We have not consumed, and that's one of the reasons why these messages are lying into the queue. If you want to look at the message payloads from the UI, when you say, I'll just try to requeue it so that, because I want to do a node restart and then see that. So if you look at right now, there are two messages. One is a persistent message, right? And one is a non-persistent message. Now let's understand the difference. What I'm going to do is I will do the node restart. When I do a node restart, I should see only one message in a queue, which is a message which was sent with a persistent mode on. The message which was not sent in a persistent mode on is a message which is gone. So if your queue are having any messages which are non-persisted messages, and when the node goes down, which means that everything which are in the RAM will get wiped out.
Whether it's delivered or not, doesn't.
If it is not delivered, it will not be there in the queue. At
to
all.
The consumer.
Yes. To the consumer, so consumer will not have a chance to consume the message because message is not in a queue, right? So now I'll go and stop the broker, and I'm restarting the broker. As I said earlier, we should see when it comes back. If you look at right now, there is only one message because the message which was non-persistent message will be removed from the queue. So, but don't get confused. If you already have a consumer which is connected to the queue, this message would have been consumed by now. But say for the instance, your consumer is processing the message at, say for the instance, 10 messages per second rate. The producers are producing the messages which are 100 seconds per second rate, which means that you might have 90 messages in the queue which are yet not processed. At that time, if your node goes down, those 90 messages will be gone if it is non-persisted message. So if you want to ensure that your messages should be should be backed when the node restarts happens. You should create a durable queue as well as you should send the persistent messages. Only creating a durable queue does not mean that every message in the queue will be persisted. So the queue needs to be durable, and the messages when you are publishing should be the persistent message, so that those messages would be returned to the persistent store. As far as RabbitMQ is concerned, RabbitMQ does support the persistence based on file systems. It does not support the JDBC base, while ActiveMQ does support a JDBC base. The discussions that needs to understand is whether I should have the persistent, every message should be persistent or not. And this is where the difference lies. The moment you tell RabbitMQ that my all message needs to be persistent, you actually get a less throughput, because the RabbitMQ needs to ensure that the messages are actually being committed, or it is actually being returned to the file systems before it sends you back that yes, message is published to the queue. So the moment you make every message to be of type persistence, you get less throughput. And there are some of the, if you take up the scenarios like order messages, right? Order messages needs to be persisted, because if the node failure happens, and when the node comes back, order needs to be processed. But in the scenarios like log messages, error messages, you don't care. If the node goes down, maybe you don't care the messages to come back, and then you are okay to deal with that situation for their systems itself. And that's where you might end up in creating up the messages which are non-persistent in the nature.
So when do we delete this persistent?
Whenever you want to ensure that even if my node goes down and comes back, my message needs to be back into the queue,
right?
So which are not processed.
That is back into the queue, and my consumer got it from the queue.
Right.
Okay, so now I want to delete it.
And while wanting it, you can requeue or not requeue. If you don't requeue it, the moment you consume it, it will be deleted. Is that right?
Right. So let me try to give the demo one more time. So over here, let's say I consume the message, and I consume with a requeue as no, which means that the message would be deleted from the queue.
Right?
Yeah, when you're consuming the messages, it has nothing to do whether it is persistent message or not. I'm consuming a message.
No, wherever you're persisting, you want to periodically delete from there.
Messages will be deleted from the queue only when the consumer sends an acknowledgement that I have consumed the message. Till the time consumer does not send an acknowledgement, the message would remain into the queue. Messages will not be deleted from the queue unless you consumed it.
So by consuming, should I mention that requeue no?
Yes. So if you say requeue no, the messages will remain into the queue. Let me quickly show you guys a small Java program sure.
So regarding that the transient queue or the durable queue, right? So where can we use this transient? So even if we have a transient, is there an option of persistence there?
So you can persist. So think of a scenario like this. You wanted your messages to be persistent. Then your queue will always be durable.
Yeah.
Because if it is transient queue, as soon as you come back, the queue is not there at all. Right? We created a transient queue, we did a node restart, and the queue was not there at all. Right?
Okay.
So if you want your messages to be persistent, then first thing is you'll be creating a durable queue.
Yeah.
Right? The only thing which a durable queue does is that when the node restart happens, the queue is already there, where you can see the messages, but only you can see the persistent and non-consumed messages. Messages which are already being picked up by the consumers will not be there in the queue. But the messages which are not being picked up by the consumer and the messages which were not being marked as a persistent message will still remain in the queue. So don't get confused. Let me show the same thing as a demo once again, right? So my queue is a durable queue. Again, I am publishing two messages. One is non-persistent message, which I marked as message not to be persisted. So this is a non-persistent message which has been published. Now I'm publishing a persistent message, and I'll be just telling it that message to be persisted. And I publish the message. But there is a lot difference between these two messages. I have two messages in my queue. Both the messages are not consumed. I don't have any consumers to consume my messages. If this message has been consumed, there is no question because the queue will not have any messages. Right. But in a messaging infrastructures, it does not matter when you consume the messages, because that's what the queue's capabilities are. Queues is more like a buffer. It contains messages till it is getting consumed. What we are talking about is a node restart. In a scenario when the node goes down, right? When the node goes down, the messages which are being marked as a persisted messages will come back to the queue so that it can be consumed by the consumer, whatsoever the consumers are there. But the messages which are being marked as a non-persisted messages will not survive on node restart. If a message is already consumed, there is no question whether it is transient or non-persisted message. When the message is persisted, that's where the node restart scenario comes into a picture. Restart the node, the messages which are only persisted will remain in the queue, remaining thing will be gone.
What about the requeuable?
Which one?
Requeuable.
Requeuable is something whereby it says that when you consume the message, you delete the message from the queue. It is like sending an acknowledgement to the queue that I have successfully consumed the message.
So let's say we don't want to
delete. If you don't want to delete, you'll say requeue no. So say for the instance you are getting the message and you say requeue queue. Right? So you receive the message from the queue.
Let's restart the node and see
what happens. Right. So if you see over here, the number of messages are gone from the queue. Because you said requeue is equal to no, which means that you have successfully consumed the messages. Now let me say I publish the message, first message, again, same scenario. I publish a message which is a non-persisted message, right? So I again now have the two messages, right? And here I'm saying that requeue is equal to yes. Requeue is equal to yes means I'm consuming the messages, but I'm not sending an acknowledgement to be removed the message from the queue. This is just the testing. When I do a Java program, I'll show you that the Java program, which is a consumer, which sends an acknowledgement to the queue that remove the message from the queue because I successfully consumed. Requeue yes is a scenario when on the consumer side, there is some exception so that the message can be reprocessed, right? So here, you get the message requeue is equal to yes, so you can still the messages over here, but the messages are not removed from the queue. Now I'll do a node restart, right? Messages has not been consumed. Now I'm doing a node restart. So when I do a node restart,
but message is consumed but not
acknowledged.
Not acknowledged, right? Messages are consumed but not acknowledged. Say for this, so I have two messages yet to be consumed. Before the consumer consumes the message, the node restart happens. Right, so node is stopped, starting the node back. And over here, if you'll see, there is only one message which came up. It does not have the second message, because second message, which was in the queue, was actually in memory. And everything which is in memory does not survive on the node restart. You guys which are on the WebEx, they can ask the question if they have any. All right. So let me go ahead and do something different now. So I have the queue, which is a durable queue in which we had the one message which is there. The name of the queue is Clairvoyant Queue Durable. Now, before I actually go ahead and then show the Java program, let me show the routing and binding. So on the exchanges side, as I said, it allows you to publish the message to the exchange. Up till now, what we did, we published the message to the queue directly, right? Now over here, I'm creating an exchange. Say for instance, the name of the exchange is Clairvoyant Exchange. There are different types of exchanges. Let me start with a direct exchange. So I'm creating a direct exchange over here. Again, my exchange as the queue, which is of durable or transient, my exchanges can be transient also, which means that when the node restart happens, exchange does not remains there. And I'm creating an exchange, right? So if you look at the Clairvoyant exchange, which is right over here, which is marked as a durable, it does not have any binding to the queue, which means that if you publish the message to the Clairvoyant exchange right now, it does not know where to publish because it does not have any queue binding over there. Let's see. So I'm publishing a message, say for instance, publish message. And then if you'll see, the message is published to the exchange, but it says it is not routed because there is no binding, there is no routing which has been given. What is routing? Routing is something by which you tell exchange that this is my routing key, and based on this routing key, you publish this message. So let's now provide a binding over here. So what are we going to do? We are in the exchange, which is a Clairvoyant exchange which has been created, and over here, what was the queue name? The queue name was Clairvoyant Queue Durable, right? So I'm going back to the exchange, which is our Clairvoyant exchange. And here in the queue, Clairvoyant Queue Durable. This is my queue name, right? Routing key. Say for instance, whenever the message is to be published to the queue, which is with a routing key C1, it will be published to the queue. So when the message is being published to the queue, it provides two things. One is to what exchange you are publishing and to what routing key you are publishing. So whenever the message comes to the queue, it says, okay, this message belongs to me. So the exchange picks up the message and then it compares the message routing key. And then when the message routing key is C1, it will automatically publish the message to the Clairvoyant queue durable, and that's where the binding is. So here I provided the binding over here. So if you look at the binding now, it says that publish this message to this queue whenever the routing key is C1. So now instead of publishing the message to the queue directly from the exchange, I'm publishing a message. So I'm publishing a message with a routing key C1, right? And here message from exchange. The message is published.
Now if we go to queue.
Now if we'll go to the queue, you should see that the message has been published.
What's the advantage of having
this? So you cannot publish the message to the queue directly.
We just did before
because the every queue by default is bound to a default exchange. And to the default exchange, the routing key is nothing but the queue name itself, right? So if you look at over here now, there are two bindings which is with this queue. So someone is publishing a message to the default exchange with a routing key as a queue name, it will be published to this queue. Someone is publishing the exchange to the exchange named as a Clairvoyant exchange with a routing key C1, it will also be published to the queue, which means that one queue can have multiple bindings. Your message to the queue can be published from multiple exchanges. And as I said earlier, publisher does not know about the queue names. Publisher knows about only to what exchange with what routing key I'm publishing a message. Right? So now to just show you the demo, I'm going to the default exchange. Right, so my queue has got two bindings. One is a default exchange binding and one is my own exchange binding. Both are the direct exchanges. I'm going to the default exchange binding and with the routing key, which is Clairvoyant queue durable. And I'm publishing a message. Message from default exchange. I already published the message from my own exchange with a routing key C1. But now I'm publishing a message from default exchange with the routing key same as a queue name. And both of these messages will go to my queue. So when you say publish the message is published. Go back to the queue. And if you'll see, there are three messages now. The message has just been published. If you look at the number of messages in the queue, I'm keeping requeue here so that messages will not be deleted from the queue. This was the message from the default exchange. This was the message from the exchange, which is your own exchange, which was published with a routing key as C1 because that's what your binding was. And this was published to the default from the default exchange with the routing key as the name of the queue itself. So please understand, whenever you create a queue by default, it is bound to a default exchange. You have not created a default exchange. Broker will provide you the default exchange by default. As soon as you'll see onto your own machine, kind of.
Sure. The routing key, should the publisher send this routing key also?
Yeah, publisher must send two things. To what exchange you are publishing a message, and to what routing key, with what routing you are publishing a message.
Publisher deciding which queue it has to go.
Publisher does not decide which queue it has to go. Publisher actually decides that what is my routing key. When I'll give you a fine out demo, when you are publishing a message with one routing key, it might be replicated to the 100 queues because it is a broadcast. The publisher does not tell that you publish my message to 100 queues.
Oh,
it is an exchange binding which decides that this message should go to which queue. Right? And to answer your question, let me show you the demo of the fanout exchange. So the direct exchange is a point-to-point exchange. You publish message with one routing key, it goes to only one queue. In the fanout, it's a broadcast. I send you one message, that will be replicated to all the queues. Publisher does not know. Publisher does not care to which queue the message is going. All queues can have the same message. Right. So I'm creating now a fanout exchange. Fanout again is a broadcast exchange. So here I'm creating exchange, Clairvoyant exchange fanout. And this exchange is of type fanout, right? I created an exchange, right? Now, I'll go to the queues and I'll create three queues. Q1, Q2, and Q3. So I have three queues. If you look into the queues, these queues are not bound to my fanout exchange. Right now it is just bound to the default exchange. As I said earlier, as soon as you create a queue, it is bound to a default exchange. What is a routing key for this queue?
The queue name.
What is a queue name? Q1, right? Perfect. So the routing key for this queue is Q1. If you go back to your exchange, go to the fanout exchange, right? And then now I'm creating a binding, which means that fanout exchange tells that I'm bound to the Q1. So here it tells that Q1. I'm not giving a routing key because I know that my exchange is a fanout exchange. So it is bound to the fanout exchange. If you look at routing key, it is blank. I'm binding my second queue. Correct? Which means I have a fanout exchange which is bound, which is having three queues, right? And now I'm publishing a message. So when I'm publishing a message from the exchange, right, which is as good as like a publisher, which is telling that I'm publishing your message, I don't provide you a routing key. So I publish the message. This is a broadcast message. Now, let's go back to the queues. And if you'll see all the Q1, Q2 and Q3, all of these three queues has got one message, which is as good as the message has been broadcasted. This is not point to point. You publish the message and then it get copied to all the queues.
Did we just send a message?
Yeah, we just sent a message from the queue. Let me send another message from the, so I'm going to the exchange, which is our fanout exchange, and I am publishing a message. This is broadcast message 2, and I'm clicking on publish. Where are you publishing a message? You are publishing a message to the fanout exchange. You have not provided any routing key because fanout exchanges does not need to have the routing key. And when you publish, goes to the queues, and if you look at, there are two messages. Each queue now contains two messages. If you go inside the queue, and if you'll try to see what messages are, let me see what my two messages contain. So if you look at, this is the broadcast message 2, and this was my first broadcast message.
So let's say I have 100 queues, and I want to create a fanout
exchange. Right.
Does it mean I have to go bind all my queues to that exchange?
You can do it programmatically. You don't need to do an admin way, kind of. So this is what we did. In one of the architecture that we created, we had 700 physical stores. Each store used to have their own queue, right? There are some of the promotions which comes in, which is, say for instance, buy one, get one promotions, which were supposed to be for across all stores. So what we used to do is messaging systems will accept that promotion. Basically, the middleware will accept the promotion and it will publish to the fanout exchange to which all the queues are bound. So if there is another store which comes up, the store itself will be creating a queue, which is nothing but as soon as you create a subscriber to a queue, the API allows that if a queue is not existing, it will create a queue. The subscriber itself can say that my queue is bound to this fanout exchange.
But either programmatically or manually, it has to be.
Exactly. Fanout. It has to. You cannot.
Just because it's fanout doesn't mean that it has access.
No. So that's what is something which is called as a binding. So you need to tell a binding stating that I am bound to this exchange. And that is the reasons why whenever you create a queue, they automatically create a default binding, because the queue without any binding is of no use. You will never be able to publish a message to the queue which is not bound to anywhere. And that is why it is always being bound to a default exchange. All right, this sounds great. Now, a couple of things. Now, let's do some of the deep dive. So I have the durable queue over here, right, in which I already have the three messages. I want to consume this message using a Java program. So what I'll do is I'll switch back to the consumer side. As I said into the diagram, let me just show that diagram once again. If you look at this diagram, the consumer connects to the queue whenever it needs to consume the messages. That's where no routing, no exchange comes into a picture. Whenever you are publishing a message, that's where routing and the exchanges comes into a picture. So let's go back to the program. This is my consumer. So the consumer wants to consume the message from the clairvoyant durable. And if you look at this operation, it has a second operation which states that it is basic true, which means that it sends an acknowledgement that I consumed the message successfully, delete from the queue, which is as good as a requeue option which we evaluated when we are consuming the message from the web UI. So here I'm consuming the message. The thing with the basic get is this is consuming only one message at a time. If you want to consume three messages, you'll be writing down the three. So this is more like This is just for the demo, because in a real life situation, you'll never do this. In a real life situation, you'll have a consumer which is always consumed, ready to consume the messages. And I'll show you the Java program which will do that too. So I'll talk about these connections and everything, but I just want to show that whether I'm able to consume the messages or not. So if you'll see, message to be persisted is consumed, which means that you have consumed only one message, and you send an acknowledgement that yes, I have successfully consumed the message. So if you'll go back to the queue now, if you'll see, one message has been consumed. The message has been deleted from the queue. Now I go back to my program. Now I'm consuming a message, but I'm not sending an acknowledgement. I have not sent an acknowledgement, which means that my message will not be deleted from the queue. So when we'll run this program, it says that message from the exchange, but message is still not deleted from the queue. So your queue still had the two messages. Now I'm consuming the message. So again, I got the same message, which is as good as I consumed the same message, but this message has been deleted over here from the queue. And let me consume the another message so my queue would become empty. So this was the message which we have published from the default exchange with the routing key named as a queue name. And then now the message is deleted from the queue. So this is nothing but the API. Now let me show you how we are always ready to consume message as far as consumers are concerned, because we cannot initiate the Java program so that, you know, I got a message in a queue, let me consume it. Like, so this is more like something which is called as a subscription sort of things, whereby what you tell is that I want to consume the message from this queue, and whatever queue name, our queue name is Clairvoyant queue durable, right? So this is interesting. So if you look at over here, this is nothing but something which is called as a callback function. As soon as the message is available, as soon as the message is published by the publisher in a queue, my this function will get invoked automatically, which is more like I'm always in a ready mode to consume the message. But let me just remove some of this stuff so that, so over here, whenever the message is published into the queue by the publisher, the consumer will consume the message. Handle delivery operation will automatically be called, right? Which is as good as like it will spawn the new thread, and then it will invoke this handle delivery method. And it sends an acknowledgement that yes, I have consumed a message, right? So basically I'm not talking about an exception over here. So right now, whenever you will run this program, if you'll see, it is ready to receive a message. It has not, the handle delivery is not being called because it does not have any of the messages available. Let me, using my web UI, and then I'm publishing a message. So to publish the message, you can do it in three ways. As far as web UI is concerned, you can go to the queue and publish the message, which you should not do, because you should always go to the exchange and then publish the message, right? So I'll go to the Clairvoyant exchange. My routing key is C1. So I'll publish the message with the routing key C1 and test message. I have not published the message. So if you look at right now, my consumer has no message. I'm sending a message. So the message has been published. If you look at, it has already received the message from the exchange, from the Clairvoyant exchange, with a routing key, paste message, which is nothing but my message payload. I'm more interested in a message payload, but just from the logging perspective, I'm logging that my message has come from Clairvoyant exchange with a routing key C1, and that's where this envelope comes into a picture. So if you look at an handle delivery method, it gives you a body. So your message does not need to be textual. It can be any binary data. You can produce the images into the RabbitMQ, and you would not be having the use case to do that, but your messages are nothing but the blobs, it's a binary data altogether. So my message has been consumed over here. If I look at the queue, my queue should not have any message over here, right? Now, I'm consuming a message, but I'm not sending an acknowledgement, which means that I will restart my program now, right? So I should see that the message has been consumed, but it has not been sent as an acknowledgement over here. So what will happen is, I'll go back to the exchange again. Where I want exchange. Routing key is C1. Again, test message. All right, so if you look at the message has been consumed. Let me check into my queue. So if you look at the queue, this queue still has the message. That's the good thing. So whenever you create a queue, you can tell that my queue has got a property that if a message is not being consumed in 10 seconds, then it should be deleted. Or you can put in a policy stating that if a message is not being consumed in 10 seconds, it needs to be deleted. Which means that I want to notify someone that, this message is important. It was supposed to be consumed in 10 seconds, but it is not consumed. Let's do that. So what I'll do is, the existing queue itself, you can add a policy, but just from the simplicity perspective, I'm just creating a queue again. So I'll go ahead and create, say for the instance, test queue with TTL capabilities, as you're saying, when the message needs to be deleted. So I'm creating a queue which is having a TTL capabilities. If you look at whenever you are creating a queue, up till now we have seen that the queues can be durable or transient. We know that it does not survive on a node restart. I'm now giving, I'll cover up that as soon as I'll answer this. So the TTL, I'm giving, I believe this is in milliseconds, right? So I'm giving it that after 10 seconds, if a message is not consumed, it needs to be deleted. So I'll go and having that. So if you look at now my test queue TTL, it has got a TTL capabilities. Any messages which are being published to the queue, if it is not consumed in 10 seconds, it needs to be deleted. So I'll go back and test message to be deleted after 10 seconds. That's my sample payload. Message has been published. I do not have any consumer right now. So if you look at the number of listed consumer, there are no consumer over here, which means that the message is over here. If you look at the queue, the message is gone because after 10 seconds, your policy states that the message has to be deleted. But you don't want to do this, right? You would not like your message to be deleted, but you should like your message to be picked up by someone else, which is more like a high priority thing. Something is going wrong. There are no consumers. The message needs to be deleted. And to do that, you can actually register a deleter queue. You can actually register a deleter exchange. So let's do that. So what I'm going to demo is, I'm going to create a queue which has got two attributes. One is an attribute whereby I have TTL capabilities that after 10 seconds, my message will be deleted if it is not consumed. And if a message is deleted, I want that message to be deleted, which is means that that message should be pushed to some other exchange so that it can be picked up. That exchange can be a direct exchange or fan out exchange or anything. So to show that, simply say for the instance, you can actually in the existing queue, you can add that capabilities, but I'm just test TTL and DLX. DLX stands for deleter exchange. I'm creating a queue. As I said, I have a capabilities that I am putting up an attribute that after 10 seconds, it will be deleted. But I don't want the message just for the sake of deletion, it will be removed from the queue, but it should be pushed to some other notifications queue. So here you can actually provide a dead letter exchange, which is nothing but an exchange name. It can be an any exchange. It can be a default exchange. It can be your own exchange. So say for the instance, let's push this message to the fanout exchange. What was the name of the fanout exchange? Clairvoyant. Was it Clairvoyant Exchange fanout?
Yeah.
Let me just verify. So Clairvoyant Exchange fanout. Where were we? So I'm test TTL DLX. Ten seconds. Dead letter exchange. And I'm going to have Clairvoyant Exchange fanout.
Yeah.
Exchange fanout. Thank you. All right. Thank you, Chiranjeevi. Clairvoyant. Perfect. So if you look at now, or this was, so I have now a queue which has got a TTL capabilities as well as it has a dead letter capabilities also. I'm going there and then publishing a message. So the message has been published. There is a message. After 10 seconds, this message will be removed from the queue. But when it is going to be removed from the queue, it will be dead letter. So the messages can be dead letter in two scenarios. If a consumer is rejecting a message, that will also be dead letter. If a TTL is expired, at that time the message will also be dead letter. So I'll show you from the Java program also. So, but to show this right now, what was a dead letter exchange? The dead letter exchange was nothing but your fanout exchange, and fanout was like a broadcast. So which means that you should see all of these three queues having a new message which has come up. Because you pushing the message as a dead letter exchange to the fanout exchange, and fanout is a broadcast, so that message has been picked up by the three queues kind of. Cool. Okay. Now, any questions on this? So let's recap what we did. We see what is a direct exchange, point-to-point exchange. We see what is a fanout exchange, which is a broadcast exchange. We saw what is a durable exchange and the transient exchange, which is durable, which survives on to the node restart. We saw what is a persistent message and what is a non-persistent message, whereby the node restart will have the messages in the queue which are not consumed, which are not yet consumed, but the transient messages will be removed from, non-persistent message will be removed from the queue. All right. Now, let me show you the capabilities of a work queue. What is a work queue? So, in a scenario when you want to have the consumers which are highly available, which means that you want multiple consumers to consume the message in the queue. So say for instance, if the messages are coming into the queue at 100 messages per second, you want to have 10 consumers so that each consumer will pick up 10 messages per second, right? So I have this test queue, right? And I'm just going to do a consumer which will connect to the test queue and start consuming the messages. And each message I'll acknowledge. All these Java programs are available into my GitHub repository, which is available in the presentation. So I'll send up that up to everyone. So I have one consumer, right, which is being registered. I have second consumer which is also registered. I have third consumer which is also registered. So you can create a small program which as soon as you start it will create 10 different threads, and each thread will be registered as a consumer. So if you look at right now, I have three consumers which is registered to pick up the message from my queue. If you look at your queue, you have three consumers which are registered. So your management GUI on a debit and queue gives you, which shows you everything transparently, that how many messages, how many consumers, how many messages are lying, at what rate messages are being published, at what rate messages are being picked up, and everything. None of the consumers they are in a listening mode, right? So this is nothing but something like a highly available consuming system, because if, even if one of the consumer goes down, there are other consumers which should pick up your messages. How many consumers you register, that all depends on at what rate or at what frequency you wanted your messages to be consumed, kind of. So I'm just pushing in the three message. Paste one, paste two, and paste three, which means that the three messages have been pushed up. If I look at my three consumers, first consumer has picked up the taste one message, second consumer has picked up the taste two message, and third consumer has picked up the three taste three message, which means that you have now the scalable systems so that even if the multiple messages are being published at the more frequency, you would be able to consume the messages at a higher rate. This is round robin, right? So each of them will pick up one message at a time. So UI will say that I don't have any message because all messages has been sent an acknowledgement that remove the message. But if you look at the rate over here, it was almost like, since I was clicking on manually, it was almost like 0.2 messages per second. No. The web UI will not tell. Web UI will tell that how many consumers you have registered which are ready to consume the message, and how many messages which are yet to be processed. No. You don't have control that this message should go only to the from the broker perspective. Each consumer is same. If you have 10 consumers and 10 messages comes, it just, as Chiranjeevi said, it is round robin. It will just go in the round robin fashion to each and every consumer's number. There are scenarios whereby you might have the consumers which are taking more time to process the messages and all those, but that's the different architecture evolutions altogether. And there are various messaging patterns that we can create by which the same thing can be done. All right, so I want every one of you to do an installation of RabbitMQ on your machine, and then just do the small play around with the fan out and the direct exchanges. So let me show you how you can actually do the installation. So if you look at the installation instructions, we need to have the we need to install the Erlang first on your machine. So just go ahead and download this org package.erlang.com. This will install the Erlang. And second is this to be Rabbit MQ installation. And go under the package, go to the Rabbit MQ server as pin, and then do the start the broker. Okay, so if you guys can follow these steps with me, is it possible I can push in the messages over here? Okay, in the chat window, this is the Erlang installation. So if you click on this link on the chat window, you should see this Erlang package. If you are on a Mac, this is, and if you're on the version 10.10, just click on download. This should be installable. Once that's being installed, so install that again. RabbitMQ will give you the tarball. So that tarball is for the Mac, we'll download this. For the Windows people, they will download this. And then once the tarball is being downloaded into your download directory or something, as I said earlier, you'll do tar xvf. I'm pretty sure every one of you must be aware of. Just give the tarball, so this will create this package. Go to the sbin directory and say /rabbitmq server. So let me push in that to the chat window. From the RabbitMQ, this one, yeah, not the source one. If you are on the Windows, then download this. As far as Windows is concerned, I think I have the, for the Erlang, I have a separate link. So let me show that. Anyone on the Windows box from the WebEx people?
Yeah, yes, Parishan. Okay. Give me the Windows link. Yeah.
Okay. I'll be sending these all session notes and everything at the end of the sessions to you guys. Just one second. So Windows, this is from where, yeah, you guys can take 5 minutes. Timeout from the book. Timeout? Okay. Go to the SP. Did you check whether you have your name installed? Hopefully, we should have time. Oh, because you, why did you give it like this?
How did you see, there is a space, that's why it is running.
Yeah,
because that's where it is completely. So I can just move your everything. She will
remove that. No,
that's fine. That one just installed to your
hands. No, delete
it. Or you can delete that. No. So by default the management plugin is not enabled. Let me send you the instruction by which you can enable the plugin. So go again to the spin directory. And enable the plugin using this command.
Are you ready to start?
Okay. Okay.
How long is this one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you have anything like GPA or GPC or any of the events? Yeah, but it is not. Now there is one thing on. It's in the degree, it's in the degree, and it's in this command. Did you enable the management plugin? The last one you checked in the it should be the same as on the screen. Yeah, if you're in a position to open the web 15672, it asks you for the username and password. The username is guest, password is guest. That's the default user by which you should be able to log in. Guest guest. Those who are on the Webex, I have pushed in the instructions on the chat window. Okay, so the two things needs to be done. Create a fan-out exchange, register 3 keys to it, and create a direct exchange with your own browsing key. Now, from the exchange, publish the message with routing key. So, you are in exchange. You don't have message. You can see a binding in the queue. So, if you look at now, same binding you can see from your exchange also. So you can see the binding from two places. Go to the queue and see the binding, or go to the exchange and see the binding. Yeah. Yeah. But publish the message always from the exchange. Because for the simplicity, I was publishing from queue, but published from exchange. Okay. Anyone from the Webex needs any help?
No, I'm going through it. I'll try it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Should send it to the MPEG-QT. Is it a fan-out exchange? The fan-out exchange to which we attend, yeah, it's a fan-out. So I don't think for any existing scene you can change it as a type. So here is why. So if you are publishing a message now into the canon exchange with a routing key, which could go to only this guy. Or you already did that.
Yeah, I already did that.
So here is the thing. Whenever you are creating a finite exchange, actually routing key is of no use. Because you are doing a broadcasting. Right? Even though it allows you to associate a routing key, but I would put it like don't associate, because that means you are talking about something either a topic exchange or a direct exchange. So in case if any one of you wants to have my access to the Java program, which I showed that in GitHub.
But direct exchange can even broadcast, right?
Direct exchange can never broadcast.
I mean, I could
From direct exchange, let me just come.
Yeah.
I sent in the Java program link. So if someone wants to do a Java API, they can do that.
Create a direct exchange.
Okay. This is the direct exchange.
Same routing key.
Okay. So that means you are giving the same routing key.
Which is equivalent to what we have the power.
But think of it, for 100 exchange, for 100 queues, you cannot keep on creating a routing queue system, right? Instead of that, you should actually do the parameters. You can do like this. It's not that you cannot do that, but you want to broadcast.
But in that case, they would prefer to go with that.
Be the same routing key. Then it will go to only one of you can do an unbind. So if you look at the UI,
then
it's, So in case if you have the same routing key, if you want to change it, unbind it with an existing routing key and then supply it.
What is this header type?
Headers and topic is what we are going to cover next. We are still left out with the three items. One is clustering and mirroring key capabilities, header exchanges, and topic exchanges. I don't think so. You have to finish today. This is almost a year. Sure. No, I was thinking the same because we just don't want to be in a hurry and then finish it up the remaining part. Like, and then you guys can do a play around with the Java API because that makes more sense. Since the setup is done on your machine, just prep the project and then write down your own. So before I wrap up, let me just show.
Right. it's pretty worthy and fairly decent.
Sure. So, yeah. So this current project is already having the Spring AMQP one. The second point is the use cases. So one is an multi-source one that we actually use that we can see. So I'll create some architectural diagram for the next sessions, and then we'll do it. So how did we use it at the MQL and what was the reasons to use it? I actually wanted to cover another use case, but I was not having any diagrams, so we can cover up that as how the legacy systems got transitioned into the broker-based systems. So we'll cover up those two use cases in the next session too. All right, so just quick heads up, the program, the Java program which you guys are having, you need to do an exercise of creating a basic publisher over here. So over here, let me just quickly take you guys to the, how does the Java API actually, sorry. Right. So everyone can see the screen? Guys are on? All right. So there are different programming languages, APIs available. So if we'll go to the WebMQ, you can pretty much find out the programming languages in which the APIs are available. So as I said earlier, irrespective of which language was being used in which the RabbitMQ is being developed with Erlang, you can pretty much use any programming language to do whatever it you want. It basically is, the two basic things is like connecting to the RabbitMQ, right, opening up a channel. As I said, the channel difference between the channel and the connection. Connection represents the TCP connection, while the channel is more like a virtual connection by which you can send the MQTT commands. So in a typical program, you should actually use only one TCP connection, which is your connection, and then you can send or consume as many messages as you want using the channel. So, and one of the reasons of RabbitMQ having a channel is TCP connections are always costly in terms of being getting things opened and closed kind of stuff. So at the application startup, just open up the connection and your each thread can actually open and close the channels as many times as you want. So here, if you look at in the sample program, we create the connection factory, we provided it the host code, the username and the password, which is the same one. We got the connection from the factory, and then we got the channel. And the channel will give you the complete capability. So if you, over here, these declare is nothing but something, if the exchange and the queue does not exist, it will create it first. So this exchange declare will create an exchange which is named as a promo exchange one, which is of the type promo exchange. The queue stands for the durable exchange. As you know that when we created the exchange or the queues, it can be a durable, which survives on node restart. Same way we created a queue also. So queue has got multiple things. One is whether the queue is durable or not. I'll cover up the exclusive and the auto delete features in the next session because that needs to be demoed. But in a simple way, auto deletes are those queues which gets deleted automatically as soon as the registered consumers gets unregistered. At least if it does not have any registered consumers, it gets deleted. So that's an auto delete. And then you provided the queue binding, which is basically you said that to this queue, to this exchange, this is my route, this is my binding name, which is basically, whenever you bind, you know that you do the three things in binding. To what exchange you are binding, from what exchange to what queue you are binding, and you are binding with what routing key. So that's what the queue binding means.
and then you publish the message. So these three statements would stand redundant because you don't need to have the statements getting repeated every time. It is as good as the application starts. If the queues or the exchanges and the binding is not present, we'll create it for you. But if it is already there, you'll just go ahead and then publish the message. And as I said, when you publish the message, you'll just say that to this exchange with this routing key, I am publishing a message. Right. When you are publishing the message, you can provide some of the properties. And one of the properties that we understood is the persistent property, whereby whether your message needs to be persisted or not. So that's where and then the message gets published. On the consuming side, we have two main programs. One is the single message consuming, which is a basic GET method. So once you get the channel, you just get the message from the consumer. And this is like your acknowledgement flag, which states that the message is being acknowledged. This is the subscription, in which you are in a constant listening mode, and you are consuming the message with an auto commit false. So you are explicitly going to say that, yes, I am good with the message consumptions and I'm committing, which is basically a basic ACK. I'll cover the reject, basic reject in more detail in the next sessions. Data exchange. So I'll show up that using programs that it actually went to the data exchange. So just do a play around with the publisher, consumers, and the subscription part. I have, as I said earlier in the discussions that I will show the demo, this is the demo whereby the publishers would get a notification that the routing does not exist, the binding does not exist whenever it publishes the message, right? And that's where when you are publishing a message, you can see a mandatory flag over here, the third flag, which is a mandatory flag. This flag states that if a message is being published with a non-existing routing key, right, which is like a routing key, so that in a situation when the exchange is not able to route the message because you provided a wrong routing key, in that case, you will get a notification, which is nothing but your return message listeners will get call, which states that, sorry, I don't have that routing key available, which is existing in your message, into your messaging infrastructure. So just try to write down a small program whereby you're publishing the message with a wrong routing key, ensuring that it is not existing. And you should see that your handle return callback function is actually invoked. No. Don't get confused. So data exchange is something which we are talking about on the consumption side. That you consume the message, something went wrong, and you are rejecting the message so that it goes to the data exchange. This is publisher. Publisher is publishing a message with a wrong routing key, and the publisher should be able to come to know that message is actually not being delivered. Because exchange would drop that message. But the publisher will never come to know if you'll not provide this flag as true. If you'll provide this flag as true, and if you have a return listener which is registered with your channel, then only it will come to know, you'll come to know at a publisher side that yes, message is not being routed. The need of dead letter has nothing to do with this. Publisher has nothing to do with a dead letter exchange. Publisher wants to know that my message has to go to the queue. In a scenario when you have a wrong routing key, it does not go to the queue. But then publisher does not know if you don't provide this flag as true and then having a handle beta. Right? So this is more like a robust programming side. On the publisher side, he's aware that everything is going good. He just cares for message to be published. He does not care for the consumptions. The consumption side wants to make sure that my messages are dead letter if I'm rejecting it. And that's where the dead letter exchange comes in the picture. If you if we'll do a, we can cover the data layer exchange maybe next time, once again, just as a part of recap, so that you guys can actually do some small clear.
Setting up the
tools
and all the things on the fly.
Yeah, yeah. So when you guys were not here, I just showed them this thing, which is into my publisher program, this declare part, these channels declare part, right? It will automatically create exchange, create queue, and create a binding. So whenever, this is basically the Java API base. So whenever you are publishing a message, not necessarily the exchange and the queue should be existing. Okay. Thank you so much. I'll send this, the presentations and the couple of other materials which I have prepared for you guys on the mail itself. Thank you.
Which make it more easier.